Assalamu alaikum. Class, today we will discuss in this lesson about the phylogenetic relationship of amphibians. We will also learn the evolutionary perspectives of amphibians. Let me discuss about some evolutionary perspectives first. Who, while walking along the edge of a pond or stream, has not been startled by the plop of an equally startled frog jumping to the safety of its watery retreat? Or who has not marveled at the sounds of a chorus of frogs breaking through an otherwise silent spring evening? These experiences and other like them have led some to spend their lives studying members of the class Amphibia. The members of the class Amphibia includes frogs, toads, salamanders, and caecilians. This class name implies that amphibians either move back and forth between water and land, or live one stage of their life in water and another on land. One or both of these descriptions is accurate for most amphibians. Mostly the amphibians are tetrapods. Tetrapods mean they have four pods or foot. The term tetrapod is non-taxonomic designation that applies to all vertebrates other than fishes, and most tetrapods exhibit adaptation for life on land. Now let me discuss about the phylogenetic relationship. During the first 250 million years of vertebrate history, the adaptive radiation resulted in vertebrates filling most aquatic habitats. Because the early amphibians were appeared in the Devonian period, and that era was Paleozoic era according to the geological timescale. The early amphibians appeared when the fish was fully diversified, and that at that time the freshwater bodies was developed, and the early amphibians also dwelt in the water. The age of the beginning of the period in million years according to the GTS is 420 million years. The prehistoric water contained many active, powerful predators. Land, however, was free of vertebrates and, except for some arthropods, was free of predators. Because at that time, most of the species was present in water only. Less species are present on the land, and most of them were arthropods. Animals that moved around the water's edge were not likely to be prey for other animals. With lungs for breathing air and muscular fins for scurrying across the mud, these animals probably found sample food in the arthropods that lived there. The major component of the diet of most modern amphibians is arthropods. This is a picture of amphibian tree frog. The scientific name of this amphibian tree frog is Hyla andersoni. Amphibians like this tree frog, Hyla andersoni, are common vertebrates in most terrestrial and freshwater habitats. Their ancestors were the first terrestrial vertebrates. Let me discuss the adaptive radiations of amphibians. Adaptive radiations of amphibians resulted in much greater variety of forms than exist today. Later convergent and parallel evolution and widespread extinction clouded evolutionary pathways. No one knows, therefore, what animal was the first amphibian. But the structure of limbs, skull, and teeth suggests that Ichthyostriga is probably similar to the earliest amphibians. You can see in the picture, this is the picture of Ichthyostriga. The two lineages of early amphibians from the late Devonian and early Carboniferous can be distinguished by how the roof and the posterior portion of the skull attach to each other. One lineage of amphibians became extinct late in the Carboniferous. An amniotic egg that resisted drying evolved in this group. This lineage is called the amniote lineage. Left is its descendants, the reptiles, birds, and mammals. Second lineage flourished into the Jurassic period. Most of this lineage became extinct, but not before giving rise to the three orders of living amphibians. This lineage is known as the non-amniotic lineage. So this is the Ichthyostriga. As some zoologists thought that it is an early amphibian. So let me have some information about the Ichthyostriga. The fossils of this early amphibian were discovered in eastern Greenland in late Devonian deposits. The total length of the restored specimen is about 65 cm. Terrestrial adaptations are heavy pectoral and pelvic girdles and sturdy limbs that probably helped lift the body off the ground. Strong jaws suggest that it was a predator in shallow water, perhaps venturing onto shore. Other features include a skull that is similar in structure to ancient sarcopterygian fishes, and a fin-like tail also present. Note that bony rays dorsal to the spines of the vertebrae sport the tail fin. This pattern is similar to the structure of the dorsal fins of the fishes and is unknown in any other tetrapod. This is a cladogram. It shows some evolutionary relationships among the amphibians. In this picture, you can see that the earliest amphibians arose during the Devonian period. So a non-amniotic lineage gave rise to three classes of modern amphibians and numerous extinct taxa. The main branch having only three classes, but the taxa are many in number. And the positive signs called daggers shows that these taxa are extinct now. So what is non-amniotic lineage? The non-amniotic lineage means at that time, the organisms having no amnion layer in their eggs and they lay their egg only in water. As the amniotic lineage is that, in an amniotic lineage, the eggs of some tetrapods are adopted that they can lay their eggs on the land rather than in water. And also their eggs have an amnion layer. Some zoologists think that the class Amphibia is a paraphyletic group. So what is paraphyletic group? Paraphyletic group is a taxon that consists of a most recent common ancestor. Polyphyletic is also a term used in the sense that polyphyletic group is a taxon that consists of unrelated organisms who are from a different recent common ancestor. Means the paraphyletic is that the group having most recent common ancestor. That's why some zoologists think that the class Amphibia is a paraphyletic, that it is from most recent common ancestors. If it is true, then the three modern classes should be represented as monophyletic taxa. Monophyletic taxa matlab means it have common ancestors. The amniotic lineage of early tetrapods gave rise to reptiles, birds, mammals and other extinct taxa. Amniotic lineage of early tetrapods. The reptiles, birds and mammals also lay some eggs on land and also in water. It means their eggs have an amniotic layer. Now the daggers indicates extinct taxa, as I have told you earlier. Synapomorphic characters for lower taxonomic groups are not indicated. What are the synapomorphic characters? Synapomorphic characters are characteristic which are present in an ancestral species and shared exclusively more or less in a modified form by its evolutionary descendants. Now let me discuss that what are the evolutionary pressures on the amphibians. Most amphibians divide their lives between freshwater and land. This divided life is reflected in body systems that show adaptation to both environments. In the water, amphibians are supported by water's buoyant properties. They exchange gases with the water and they face the same. Osmoregulatory problems are faced by the amphibians as the freshwater fishes faces that problem. On land, amphibians support themselves against gravity, exchange gases with the air, and tend to lose water to the air. So, this picture shows a relationship between the early tetrapod evolution and the descent of amphibians. Tetrapods share most recent common ancestry with diverse Devonian groups. As their ancestors were the sarcopterygians, the amphibians share most recent common ancestry with diverse temnospondyls of the Carboniferous and Permian periods of the Paleozoic era, the Triassic period of the Mesozoic era. By having the same picture, we have some further phylogenetic considerations. One unresolved controversy concerning amphibian phylogeny is the relationship among the three orders of modern amphibians. Some zoologists place Anurans, Urodils, and Sicilians into a single subclass. Lys amphibia is a subclass in which all these three orders were placed by some zoologists. This placement implies a common ancestry for modern amphibians and suggests that they are more closely related to each other than to any other group. Supporters of this classification point to common characteristics such as the stapes, operculum complex, the importance of the skin in gas exchange, and aspects of the structure of the skull and teeth as evidence of this close relationship. Now, as this is a controversy, the other zoologists think that modern amphibians were derived from at least two non-amniotic lineages. They note that fine details of other structures such as the vertebral column are different enough in the three orders to suggest separate origins. If this is true, the class Amphibia is paraphyletic group. and should be divided into multiple monophyletic taxa. This controversy is not likely to be settled soon. Anthracosaurus are often cited as amphibians, ancestors of these animals, but support for this conclusion is weak still. Let me discuss the adoptive radiations of amphibians. Adoptive radiations of amphibians resulted in much greater variety of forms than exist today. Later convergent and parallel evolution and widespread extinction clouded evolutionary pathways. No one knows, therefore, what animal was the first amphibian. But the structure of limbs, skull, and teeth suggests that Ichthyostriga is probably similar to the earliest amphibians. You can see in the picture, this is the picture of Ichthyostriga. The two lineages of early amphibians from the late Devonian and early Carboniferous can be distinguished by how the roof and the posterior portion of the skull attached to each other. One lineage of amphibians became extinct late in the Carboniferous. An amniotic egg that resisted drying evolved in this group. This lineage is called the amniot lineage. Left is its descendants, the reptiles, birds, and mammals. Second lineage flourished into the Jurassic period. Most of this lineage became extinct, but not before giving rise to the three orders of living amphibians. This lineage is known as the non-amniotic lineage. So student, this was all about the relationship of the amphibians and their phylogeny. This is the last diagram. It is a tentative cladogram of the tetrapods with emphasis on descents of the amphibians. Especially controversial are the relationships of major tetrapod groups, amniota, Temnospondyl, and diverse early tetrapod groups are outgroups. All aspects of this cladogram are controversial, however, including relationship of the Lissamphibia. The relationships shown for the three groups of Lissamphibia are based on molecular evidence. Extinct groups are marked with a dagger symbol, as you know, that the early pictures are also have some dagger symbols, and this indicates that orders are extinct. So this was the evolutionary perspective of amphibians, and you can see that the early amphibians were in the non-amniotic lineage, while the modern amphibians are in the amniotic lineage. If you have any question, you can ask. This is done. Thank you.